you're actually going to get to the message. I wasn't sure if Derek was going to preach or Pastor Ryan going to preach. So get ready. I'm excited. I don't know what God's going to do, but I know it's going to be good. So for those of you who've been here the past few weeks, I was taking a look through our online archives of the past couple messages. So we had Pastor Sandra talking about changing the way you think. Pastor Jerry talking about believe. And then Billy last week was on no plan B. And the word God gave me, I think, is going to put a nice little bow on top of all of them. Kind of tie them all together. Keep your hands up if you need pen and paper. They're coming around. Thank you, ushers. You guys are awesome. So you guys are getting pen and paper because God told me he's going to start giving you vision for your life today, and you're going to need to write it down. So all throughout the message, it could be, I don't care if it's the most outlandish, craziest thing that you're like, I can never do that, write it down. Okay, write it down. I dare you. Write it down. Okay, so I actually have a word for someone, but I'm the prophetic word recorder, so is there somebody who knows that word that could help me out? Good morning. What's your name?
Tanya?
Tanya. God has a word for you, isn't it? Okay, so Father, I just thank you for Tanya, and I thank you that she's here, and she's here to learn about you, and I thank you that you have an incredible word for her. Tanya, I felt like God said that when you came in and you sat on this front row, it wasn't by mistake. He wanted you in this front row because he wanted you close to the action. That you're going to be one that's going to be able to press into him and get close to the action and hold on to that. And he said he's going to place a mantle for that on you, that you're going to have an anointing to be close to the action and to be close to what he's doing at all times. You're going to be able to press in and be close to him. And he's going to use that closeness to minister to you and also to flow out of you and minister to those around you. But it's all going to come in that closeness with him. So just press on to him. Keep going to that front row, going to the front, push and push closer to him because he's just going to make it all happen. It's not going to be a work. It's going to be just out of that closeness with him. Just thank you, Lord.
Amen.
All right, you guys all got your pens and paper?
Yeah.
Okay, so what God told me is that it's time for his body to move to the next level. And so that is what this whole message is in light of. It's time for us to move to the next level. So the first thing to move to the next level is we need a vision of that level. We need to be able to see something. Not the whole picture. Probably not the whole picture, because we probably get scared of our minds and run away. You know? But we need to have vision of where we're going so that we step in the right direction. So one thing, a quote, I don't even remember who said it. It was forever ago when I was a teenager, but I've never forgotten. He said, when God tells you to move to the next level, the level you're on becomes dangerous.
Very true.
Why does it become dangerous? Because of apathy.
Yeah.
Because the level you're on is now the old way.
You won't hang out there.
And because if you stay there, you're in disobedience. So the level we're on is about to become dangerous, and we need to move to the next level. Together as a body, as individuals, as Christians, it's time to move to the next level. So we need to catch the vision. Yeah, if you haven't already, today you're going to catch the vision. So be prepared. A man without vision is a man without a future. A man without a future will always return to his past. Yeah. A lot. For those of you who don't know, I think everybody knows, I am the youth pastor here, so I work with a lot of teenagers. And I was asking God, because I, as a teenager, was an incredibly driven teenager. I know it's kind of weird, but I was. And I had this group of teenagers at the time that weren't driven. They were apathetic. And I was like, God, how do I inspire them? Because I wasn't in their shoes. I didn't know what it was like to be an apathetic teenager, to not really care what was going on. And so I asked him, what he said vision. When they have a vision for their lives, it gives them drive. And it's the same for each and every one of us. If you're sitting there going, I'm kind of apathetic, and you're kind of don't have, you're just being tossed by the waves, whatever comes, comes, then you need to get vision. And vision creates a drive.
Ooh, there you go.
And when I was a teenager, I was driven because I had a vision for my life. At first, the vision was college, and you would not believe how driven I was. I was a straight-A student playing basketball and volleyball and any sport I can get into and every extracurricular activity I could get into so that I could get into college, a good college. But God changed my vision when I was 14, and he gave me the vision to be a youth pastor. So I quit basketball, and I got planted here and did anything and everything I could to reach the vision God gave me. So what is your vision? What does your next level look like? What does your next level look like in your personal life? What does it look like in your family? What does your part in this church at the next level look like?
Come on.
What does your next level of ministry look like? But most importantly, what is the next level in your relationship with God look like?
Yeah.
That is the most important. So what does that look like? Have you thought about it? Have you thought about where you're at? And where you want to go? What does the amount of time you spend with them look like? What does your worship look like at the next level? What does your Bible study look like at the next level? What does it look like? You write it down as God gives you things. It may sound crazy. Write it down. Write it down. We throw up Proverbs 29:18 on the screen. Where there is no revelation or vision, the people cast off restraint, but happy is he who keeps the law. We quote this one all the time. Generally, it sounds like where there is no vision, the people perish. And it's true. I know when I don't have vision for my life, I walk around like a dead person. So what does your relationship with God look like at the next level? Without vision or goals, we wander aimlessly. We get bored, and then we start to get ourselves into trouble. Am I the only one that when I'm bored, I tend to get myself into trouble?
No.
Is there anybody else? Yeah. So it's good to have vision and goals for your life. I heard a quote a couple years ago. It said, if you don't love getting out of bed in the morning, you don't have enough goals. And I was like, oh, that's weird. I was like, I don't know if I believe that. So I decided to set myself a list of goals. And it was a lot easier to get out of bed in the morning. Because I already knew what I was doing. I already knew my goal for this week is to run 10 miles. I gotta get out of bed to do that. Can't do that in bed. So it's time for us to catch God's vision for this next level in our lives. If we can catch the vision for the next season, then every day will have purpose. There's no more wandering around aimlessly. Every day has purpose. Because we're going to think, what can I do today to get me one step closer to that goal? And of course, this is the Pastor Mike famous Habakkuk 2:2. When the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it. That's why you're writing down the vision today. Because that's what the Bible tells us to do. To write the vision. When was the last time you wrote the vision down?
Last message.
So when was the last time you wrote your vision down? Even as crazy and outlandish as it seems, I can tell you when I was 14, being a youth pastor seemed totally crazy to me. I didn't even like the teenagers that I was a teenager with. So it seemed crazy. I have more dreams that seem crazier still. But we're going to get into how we connect those dots. In order to reach the vision that we're getting today, right? You guys are writing down the vision today. Right now, you're writing a vision, right? So, to get to that vision, there's a couple of things we're going to have to establish in our lives. The first is discipline. This is like the, oh, that's a Nobody likes to talk about that. I think, and I don't know this by personal experience, so I apologize if I'm incorrect, because I grew up in this church, but from what I understand, the church as a whole went through a kind of legalistic thing. And I think when we came out of that legalism, meaning it was all about the rules that nobody can actually follow, and when it was all about the legalism, when we came out of that, we lost the discipline in a lot of ways. We thought discipline was a bad word. But it's not. The Bible actually says that we should be disciplined. Can you put Hebrews 12:11 up? Now, no chastening seems to be joyful. It actually says in another version that discipline is painful. Nevertheless, afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Yes, that's it. Yeah, it does. It has disciple in it. We don't like to start disciplines because they're hard, they're painful. But the reward of them is so great. We did a whole Bible study with the teenagers on self-discipline, and there was a picture that went with the Bible study, and it was a bridge. Because building a discipline is like building a bridge. It's hard to build it, but once it's built, it's easy to cross. It's easier to keep going down that bridge once you've built it. But discipline is so important to reach our goals. It's important in our Christian walk to live a disciplined life. That's like a dead spot over there. Yeah, the one thing that I love the teenagers kept saying is that discipline isn't the absence of freedom. Discipline is actually the freedom from life-controlling habits. Yeah, these teenagers, they're good, huh? You guys should do Bible study with them sometimes and learn some stuff. They're incredible. It is not a list of rules to follow. It is setting up boundaries in your life so that you can truly be free. Because you're not free when you feel like you have to watch 2 hours of TV every night. That's not freedom. You're glued to your television. You're a slave to the TV. It's not free, I can go eat whatever I want. You can be a slave to food. Discipline enables you to be free. In Galatians 5, we're not going to go there, when it talks about the fruit of the Spirit, sometimes you just like to read through really, really fast, but one of them is self-control.
Yeah.
The fruit of the Spirit. Meaning, when Holy Spirit lives in you, a byproduct is self-control. So the self-discipline isn't so much by yourself. It's you and the Holy Spirit working together.
Amen.
To build a disciplined lifestyle. It's a teamwork between the two of you in your everyday life, in your everyday tasks. I actually looked up that original word in Galatians used for self-control, and it means dominion within. Self-control proceeding out from within oneself, but not by oneself. That's a huge key we have to remember, because when it's the Holy Spirit doing it in us and we're working together, then it becomes a transformation. If you're doing it by yourself, it's just behavior modification. So when the Holy Spirit, when it's you and the Holy Spirit working together to build a discipline, then it becomes transformation. When you're doing it by yourself, it's behavior modification.
Yeah.
Which doesn't last.
No.
It doesn't last at all.
Definitely. You can change one behavior for another.
Yeah. That's a lot of people. A lot of, you know, they smoke, they quit smoking, but they start eating sunflower seeds. You know?
More.
You're still a slave to sunflower seeds. They're better for you, so you took a step in the right direction, I suppose. But you're still a slave to sunflower seeds. Yeah. We can be a slave to anything.
Yeah.
Just because it's not illegal doesn't mean it's not something we should kick. There's an ancient proverb that says, he who hates discipline despises himself. And I have come to find that to be so true. I have spent, for those of you who hang out with me any length of time, you know in the past year and a half, I've gone a whole journey of disciplining my life. Because, and I'll just be really honest with you guys, about a year and a half ago, my dad was struggling with some health issues. My mom was struggling with some health issues. And I just woke up one morning and I went, if I can't discipline my lifestyle, I'm going to be in the same boat. So I decided to start disciplining my lifestyle. And doing it with God and with Holy Spirit and working it out. And it's been a year and a half process. But I realized that the reason I wasn't disciplined before is because I didn't really know how to love myself. Because when I love myself, I treat myself well. Right? And so I had a problem with loving myself, and so I wasn't treating myself well, and I started making justifications in my head about why my lifestyle was okay. Right? I'm young, I can eat whatever I want.
Excuses.
You know, there's so many things that we can come up with to justify how we're living.
Helpless lover.
But we gotta throw those away if we're gonna jump to the next level.
Yeah. Amen.
Who wants to go to the next level? I wanna go to the next level.
We got the room.
I am tired of this level, right? Who is tired of this level? Yeah. It was good while it lasted, I'm ready to move on, right? I don't wanna be here anymore.
Amen.
So we have to work with Holy Spirit to discipline our lifestyles to get there. What does that mean for you? I don't know, ask him. That's between you and him. He'll tell you what needs to go first. Or what needs to be added. Another thing he taught me in learning discipline was that I needed to add more people to my life. And I was like, God, what are you talking about? And he said, well, to get fit, you need to add fit people to your life. People who are better than you. So I joined the gym and I made some friends. To become closer to God, I have to add people to my life who are closer to God than I am. It doesn't mean I have to do away with who's already in my life. It just means I need to add to my life. If I want to get to the next level in ministry, I have to add people to my life who are already at that level.
Come on.
And sometimes, I don't know if this is just me, but I like to be like the best at what I'm doing. So sometimes it's hard for me to add people who are better than me because I like to be the best. I'm just going to be honest. And so it is a humbling experience, but I know it's so necessary. For me to take the next step, I have to add people who are better than me. Add something to my life. Doesn't mean they have to be better than me at everything. But at that one thing. Yeah, if they're better than me, then I'm going to add them to my life and hang out with them and see how I improve. Right? So in order to have a disciplined lifestyle, we have to begin to love ourselves. And I was preparing for this message and searching. Does anybody else use Google to learn stuff about the Bible? Okay, because I do. I tell the teenagers all the time, just Google it. So I was like typing in Google, what does the Bible say about self-love? Everything was negative. I was like, that's not what I was talking about. But a lot of people go from the negative, don't love yourself more than everybody else, which is true. Probably shouldn't be arrogant or prideful. Those are all bad things, but we do have to love ourselves.
Can I interject something?
Yeah.
One of the greatest wishes of a senior pastor or pastors is that we could raise up younger leaders to come up that can out-teach us,
yeah,
out-preach us, mm-hmm, out-prophesy us, and out-hear from God. Mama, I was 31 years old when I came to Christ. She was like 7. She grew up in a church. I didn't grow up in a church. God had to grow me up. And what I would say is it's kind of sideways to what the world thinks, because I don't want to be the best. I want to train you to be the best. And George, you're lovely to be even better to come above than others.
Yeah.
Guy, Bonnie, others that are here, it just Ben and Jen, anybody, just to come forth and grow up more in Christ and be better. Be wiser, read the word more, come alive more. And that's what the prayer is, the next level.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, I was actually learning, somebody had posted on Facebook a scripture about how, I don't know where it is, but how our children are like quivers arrows and quiver, thank you. And I asked God, I was like, God, what does that mean? Kind of like that kid did in the video, kind of on a Bible. And it's so awesome when God just answers your question. Like, it's just the best feeling in the world. So I asked him what it meant. And it was actually a Lisa the Bigger Bible study, like a week later. And she explained what that scripture meant. I was like, God, this is the answer to my question. But she talked about how our children are literally the weapons we forge and aim into the future to fight the enemy.
Yeah, that's good.
And I thought that was so incredible. But that's exactly when you raise other leaders, you guys are literally forging weapons and aiming us into the future, to fight the enemy where you may never be.
Yeah.
That's such an incredible thing. And it's more than just your biological children. Because last week, Pastor Jerry came up to Billy and I and said that there's oftentimes when we're preaching that she sees our youth pastor Gary in us. Same thing. He didn't have natural children.
Yeah.
But he sure did help shape Billy and I.
Yeah.
Amen.
So all of us, even if you don't have natural children, there are people in your life right now that you get to shape and aim.
Yep.
And you should take it as a huge responsibility how you shape them and how you aim them. So that was so not on my notes, and I wasn't paying. Sharing that. Okay. So we do have to love ourselves, and it's important for us to see ourselves through the correct lens.
Yeah.
We're not supposed to be arrogant. We're not supposed to be prideful. However, if you view yourself as anything less than God views you, then you view yourself the wrong way.
Yeah.
It's so easy for us to, anytime we're struggling with a person in our lives, we're like, God, let me see them how you see them so I can love them like you do. But why don't we pray that about ourselves?
Oh,
God, I need to see myself the way you see me so I can love me like you do.
Wow.
I know sometimes it seems like a waste of time, but it's not. I would dare to say it's really hard to reach the destiny God's called you to if you can't see yourself the way he sees you.
Yeah.
And if you need help, I'm going to give you a few scriptures. Are you ready to write? We're not going to go up to them because there's a lot. And this is just a few of what God says about you. He says you're a child of God in Galatians 3:26. He says you're a friend of Jesus in John 15:15. He says you're a new creation in 2 Corinthians 5:17. He says you're a work of art in Ephesians 2:10. He says you're forgiven in 1 John 1:9. He says you're made in his likeness in Ephesians 4:24. He says you're spiritually alive in Ephesians 2:5. He says you're a citizen of heaven in Philippians 3:20. He says you're a messenger to the world in Acts 1:8.
Come on.
He says you're a disciple maker in Matthew 28:19. He says you're the salt and the light in Matthew 5:13-14. And he says you're greatly loved in Romans 5:8. And there's so much more. if today you already know this is something you need to work on, then you need to go on a Bible treasure hunt and start finding out everything that Bible says about you.
I gotta be obedient to God. That's a great word of God. Hallelujah.
And you have worth. You have worth. So, I have this nice candy bar up here. Anybody like Snickers? I see most of you every week come to the cafe. Does anybody know how much the Snickers cost?
$1.
Why does it cost $1?
Because you made them $1. He's got to make profit.
So this Snickers is worth $1 to you, right? Right? It's worth $1. Right? If it weren't worth $1, you would buy it. If I was selling candy bars for $10 in a cafe, would you come buy a candy bar, or would you just walk over to the gas station and buy a candy bar? Yeah, right? So, somebody's paddling on you over there. So, a candy bar, it's worth $1 because you decided it's worth your dollar to get it, right?
Right?
So, the worth of this candy bar is determined by the purchaser.
Yes?
Your worth is determined by the purchaser. Your worth is determined by the one who purchased you.
Yeah. Amen.
It's not determined by any of your past circumstances.
Ain't no candy bar either.
It's not determined by any of your decisions. It's not determined by anything you're stuck in.
Come on.
Doesn't matter how you look. Doesn't matter how you feel. It was already determined by the one who purchased you.
Yeah. Amen.
He loved you.
So what are you worth? You're worth the blood of Jesus on the cross.
Yes.
You're worth him suffering and dying to give you the opportunity of life.
Wow.
And if you think of yourself as anything less than that, then you need to work on it.
Yeah.
Yes.
So how do you work on it?
Wow.
You read your Bible. You need some discipline. You namely discipline your thoughts. So a man thinks, so is he. When you use that in context of what we think of ourselves, it's just like, I know I've said it, Billy has said it at the pulpit, but it's such a life-changing picture that our potential is way up here. How we think of ourselves is probably down here.
Yeah.
And we're always going to perform where we think of ourselves. Because so a man thinks, so is he. But God created us to be way up here.
Yeah.
Wow.
And to get to the next level, we need to start thinking about ourselves correctly so that we can perform where he's called us to perform.
Good word.
So it's time to change the way we think about ourselves. So, I was asking God about this, you know, learning how to love ourselves and scriptures to go with it. And he gave me 1 Corinthians 13:7, which I always think about for my report card for how I'm loving others. But it's also our report card for how we love ourselves. And we're just going to do the last verse because it's a nice little sum up. So it says, love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. So do you bear all things when it comes to yourself? Do you believe all things when it comes to yourself? Do you hope all things when it comes to yourself? And do you endure all things when it comes to yourself? It's easy for us to think of, am I enduring everything this person's putting me through because I need to do that to love them the way God does? But am I enduring when I'm putting myself? Am I patient with myself? Am I kind to myself?
Wow.
It's a whole new report card, right? I know for me, I read through that verse and went, oh God, we need to work on this. Like, we need to work on this, right? Is there anybody else that said, oh, I think I need to work on this? I'm a huge quotes person. I guess I just realized that just now. There was a quote by some woman named Miriam, I forget her last name, that's in a sports movie, because I'm a big sports movie enthusiast. So, but it said that it was all about how our greatest fear isn't actually that we're inadequate. Our greatest fear is actually that we're powerful beyond measure. But part of this quote said, our shrinking down does no favors for anybody around us. It doesn't. Us belittling ourselves doesn't do any favors for those around us. It's actually when we're able to step out and believe we're the person that God created us to be that liberates the people around us. So have you ever read a passage in your Bible and thought, man, that person is so inspiring? Right? The things they did, so inspiring. And for me, anytime I read about Peter, I'm like, man, Peter is so inspiring to me. Yeah. You become inspiring when you see yourself the way God sees you. Because then you start operating the way that God sees you. Your performance is where God sees you. And it's when you live that life that the people around you see you and you become an inspiration and you liberate them to do the same thing. I think a lot of times our culture tries to shrink us down. Tries to fit us in boxes and shrink us down, and we've believed them. We've believed them that this is where I should fit. But it's not the truth. It's time for us to stop shrinking ourselves down and really believe we are who God says we are so that we can do what he says we can do. Like, when was the last time you raised someone from the dead?
Yeah.
The Bible says we can do that.
Yeah.
When was the last time you were witnessing and several people got saved? Because the Bible says we can do that.
Yeah.
The Bible says we can lay hands on someone and they're healed. So, is that how you see yourself? Is that what you really believe can happen in your life?
Yeah. 43 days ago, I felt dead. You know, I didn't want to be alive, and today I'm alive.
Yeah. That's amazing.
Through the being here.
Yeah.
And being here. And being present.
Yeah. That's amazing. So, in just a moment, we're going to watch a video, so Michael, if you're going to have that ready. This is a video. It is not one of the cool ones like I would usually do, but it's a really inspiring video. But I want you to listen very carefully to the words, because it's all about how we think about ourselves.
Your brain is like a circuit switch. Once you believe you are something, you actually embody. You embody that feeling. If you were, God forbid, in a coma, and you woke up and you didn't really have a memory, and you were told that you used to be a Navy SEAL, and they want you back now when you're healthy, do you think you'd act differently and hold yourself differently, conduct yourself differently, and have a different self-concept of who you are than if you were told you were a piano instructor? Being successful in life is all about having the proper belief system in who you are. Truly believing that you are something unique, that you are something special in that field. If you truly believe inside of you that you are one of the best actors in the world, you will be entirely different than if you're like, I hope I'm good. Your expressions will be totally different. Your tone of voice. You'll talk in a more convincing fashion. You use your natural voice instead of the scripted one. You'll be more emphatic. You'll be more real, more relatable. Our brain is like a circuit. And so if we introduce it with the proper wiring, you're going to go straight to your target. If you're unsure about who you are, then your dreams, your goals, they will never become a reality. Everyone has mental doubts in life, internal conflicts. Even the most successful people that you look up to, but they don't live there. It's how you handle those negative thoughts in that exact moment and overwhelm them with positive action. And that comes with this utmost confidence in yourself that you can handle the situation. Trust in yourself that you are better than the moment.
The great think differently. The great see differently, right? The great have a different worldview. The great, they approach the game in a totally different way. So I need you to read Hughes 30. I need you to think about what you're thinking about when your effort is low. Because if you can get this, you can get any success you want in life. You can have anything you want in life if you can get this. The next time you give a low effort, right? You give a 70% or 50% or 30%. I want you to think about what you're thinking about when your effort is low. If your effort is low, you're probably not thinking about the opportunity. You're probably thinking about the obligation. And when you think about E.T., how do you stay fucked up? E.T., how do you stay on fire? E.T., how do you always driven? Even in the midst of trials and tribulations, even in the midst of your haters, when people try to break you and tear you down, E.T., how do you stay strong? I keep thinking about the opportunity. Every single day, I'm thinking about the opportunity, and I'm not looking at this thing as an obligation. I'm not looking at this thing as something that I have to do, but that I'm forced to do, right? Something that somebody's making me do. Every time I wake up, I'm thinking, I'm going to love baby. This is the day. This is an opportunity. If you want what you've never had before, if you want to do what you've never done before, if you want to be what you've never been before, change your mentality. And I want you to see that effort goes up when you look at it as, I got an opportunity of a lifetime. But you should be excited about the fact that you have an opportunity.
Changing my lifestyle to a more disciplined lifestyle. And I began to wake up in the morning. When you wake up at 5 a.m. every morning, and it's still dark outside, and it's freezing cold, you have to decide, today I have an opportunity. Not an obligation. Because an obligation doesn't get you very far. But I have an opportunity. And I began to push myself harder than I pushed myself before. And that's saying quite a bit because I played basketball for a very long time. I began to push myself, and then I have a habit of I go to the gym and then I come home and I get in my word and I spend time with God. So I was at the gym pushing, and I came home and I had this thought that changed everything. And it was the simple thought, what if I did exactly that push that I do at the gym in my spiritual walk? What if I took that determination and applied it to my spiritual walk, my relationship with God? What would that look like? What if I could get up every morning and go, today's my opportunity to get closer to God? What is that going to look like for me? What is that going to look like for you? Today's another opportunity to get closer to God. Today's another opportunity to learn something new about Him. Maybe something nobody else knows. And I was reading one of Paul's writings. I don't even remember what chapter it was. but it was the Apostle Paul writing. And he literally says, like, not in these words, but I was just hanging out with God and I told you this thing, and so I wanted to share it with you, right? And it's in the Bible. Like, he was just hanging out with God. He was just having a conversation with God. They were just talking together. And he felt impressed to share it with this church. And they put it in the Bible. And I thought, God, I want to have times with you like that. That what I discuss with you is so good that it can be mass distributed to people. I want my quiet times to be like that.
Amen.
All of our quiet times can be like that. Each and every one of us. He designed all of us to hear his voice. So all of us can have quiet times for that. So what would it take for you to have a quiet time? You have to have the discipline, right? To actually spend time with him. And you have to realize that he really does love you enough to have time like that with you.
Yeah.
You really are that important to him. You really do have that purpose on this planet. There's so much that he wants to do on planet Earth. There's so much he wants to do in Nevada County. Like, I'm sure if we sat here, we could list a million things going wrong in our own county, right? If you just took a second, you could think of 3 or 4 right now, right? Just like that. He's called us to be the ones to change that.
Yeah.
So do you really believe you are able to be that change? Because you are. You were created in his likeness. There's nothing you can't do. So we've got to change the way we think. We've got to change the way we talk. Change the way we're believing about ourselves. So that we can jump to the next level in our relationship with God. So we can jump to the next level in our families, in our community, with the people around us. What does that vision look like for you? Picture it. Take a second. What does it look like? Use your imaginations. I've been trying to spend time with God and just imagining what the future is going to look like. What does it look like? What does your family life look like at the next level? What does your relationship with God look like at the next level? What does your ministry look like at the next level? And if you're sitting there going, Pastor Emily, I don't have a ministry. Yeah, you do.
Yeah, you do. What do you have in your hands?
What's around you? That's your ministry. Your job, your family, people you run into at the grocery store,
yeah.
Your friends, that's your ministry. You can make far more impact on those people than I can standing at this pulpit.
Yeah.
Far more. So what does your ministry look like? I'm going to challenge you every morning when that alarm clock goes off, if you wake up with an alarm clock, to let that vision be the first thing you see. Because once you see it, you're not going to stay in bed as long. You're not going to go run to the TV. Maybe not even a coffee pot. I'll give you a really good tip. It works your heart rate up. Once you get your heart rate up, you're awake. You're good.
Come on.
Really fast. But once you have that vision, that first thing in front of you, you're motivated. You're driven. You have purpose.
Yeah.
And it's kind of crazy. Your day just goes so much better. It does. I know it's weird, but it does. And by the end of the day, you are getting ready to go to bed, and you're like, man, that was a good day. Even if junk happened, it was still a good day because you took another step closer to God. Because you took another step closer to your vision. Even if sometimes it doesn't feel like you made a lot of progress, you're still building a habit. There's days where you don't feel progress. And in those days, remind yourself, just the habit is progress. Just that you did it is progress. Sometimes I'm with God and I'm reading my Bible and I'm like, God, I didn't really get anything awesome this time. But I have to remind myself, but I still read my Bible. I still took the time to spend with God because that is important.
Yeah.
And you don't have to do something that's boring to you.
No.
Make it exciting.
The word is exciting.
It is. If you have no idea what to read, that's probably the most common thing I hear when people aren't doing Bible studies. I have no idea what to read. Everybody pull out your cell phones. Pull out your cell phone. I'm giving you permission. There is a Bible app called YouVersion.
Yes.
They have fantastic Bible studies.
Yes.
Fantastic. Go look. There's going to be a topic you want to learn about. There's going to be something that's interesting to you. There's like 50 million on leadership that are amazing. Go read those, even if you're thinking, I'm not called to lead. Yes, you are. Change the way you think. Start reading them. There's some on marriage. There's some on raising children. There are so many.
Great word on disciples.
Yes. Yep. There are so many great Bible studies. And if you're anything like me and you get a little bored, I just start 10 Bible studies at once and I jump around. YouVersion.
Is it Y-O-U?
No, you.
Y-O-U.
I think it's you. Is it Y-O-U?
It's
Y-O-U. Y-O-U. It looks like a little brown Bible and it says Holy Bible. It's really good. Really good Bible studies. That's a jumping point. There's times where I'll do one of the Bible studies and I'm like, I kind of want to read the whole chapter that came out of. And do that. Have some freedom in your Bible studies. It doesn't have to be a list of rules or, you know, a certain way you do it. Change it up. I love to go on prayer runs. Go for a walk and pray. Spend time with God.
Amen.
Change it up. It doesn't have to be sitting at a desk with your Bible and a lamp. Unless you like that, then do that. But make it fun. I work with Jessica, who's in kids today, and we come into the office, and the first thing we do is share what we learned in Bible study. Makes it fun. And then I'm like, I don't know if I have time to read the Bible study this morning. I'm like, oh, Jessica's going to ask me. So I go and read the Bible. It's great accountability. You can actually add all the friends in your contacts, and then they can see what Bible studies you're doing. That's way fun. I've been thinking about adding Sally. It keeps asking if I want to add her. So go and find everybody you go to church with.
Absolutely.
See what they're reading. Yeah. And you can hold each other accountable. And you get to discover really cool Bible studies that way. Because you see what everybody else is reading. You're like, oh, that one sounds really good. So change it up. Pastor Jordan, if you wouldn't mind coming up. I'm almost done here. So what you have to do to get to the next level has nothing to do with what everyone else around you is doing. This is you and God. That's it. So you have to make the decision that you want to get to that next level with or without the people around you. Another good quote, be willing to do it by yourself, because not everyone who started with you will finish with you. It's not about what people say about you. The really cool thing is when you actually love yourself, other people's opinions don't really matter. When you love the choices you're making, other people's opinions about them don't really matter. It's a liberating thing to actually love yourself the way God loves you. It's not about the obligation. It's the opportunity. This is about you and God. So where do you want to go from here? The choice is yours. I can preach all day long about learning how to live a disciplined life. I can preach all day long about how much God loves you. But you have to put in the footwork.
Come on.
I can't do that for you. You have to make decisions in your life. You have to start implementing things in your life. So you want to know a few, of course. Most importantly, you need to be spending time with God every single day. Whenever that works, whatever that looks like. Because all of us are a little different. That is going to be the most important thing. The most important. Get people in your life who are better at it than you. Add people to your life who have a closer relationship with God. Ask questions. Bug them. So you can learn. Start deciding to change the way you think about yourself. How do you do that? Every time that thought comes up, you're worthless, correct it. No, not. My worth is defined by Jesus on the cross.
Right. Oh, man.
I can't do it. Yes, I can. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Pastor Mike said earlier today. I'm not the person they think I am. Doesn't matter, I'm the person God thinks I am. I can't share God's love. Yes, I can. Because he gave it to me to freely share. I know when I tell people this, they think I'm crazy. But sometimes you just have to go stand in front of the mirror and yell at yourself. Yeah. Whatever it is, that day. Maybe it's, I am a child of God. I am forgiven. I am more than a conqueror.
Yeah.
I can do this. I can be a preacher. I can share my faith with the world. I can be a light. I can make a difference in someone's life.
Yes.
I am a good parent.
Yes.
Talk to yourself in the mirror. Our words have power.
Yes.
So much more than our thoughts. But we let our thoughts run rampant and we keep our mouths shut. Open your mouth and start declaring things over yourself. Was it just last week when we were declaring over our neighbors?
Yeah.
We need to be declaring over ourselves too. We so easily slip back into thinking the old way. So we need to be declaring over ourselves so that we can change the way we think. So that we really see ourselves the way God sees us, so that we can do what he's called us to do.
Yeah. I have Curtis. I have a paper, a sheet, and it's called the I Ams. That paper, if you're trying to figure out what do I say over myself, that sheet of I Ams are all the Word of God, and it's His definition of you. When you declare those things over yourself, that's when you find yourself being transformed to be the person God sees you as. But you must do as Emily said, put it in the mirror and say it out loud so your ears hear it and your spirit hears it.
Yeah. I actually just recently read an article about the I Ams. Here's a good hint. It's probably opposite of what you're currently thinking.
Yeah.
If you're not sure, it's probably the opposite of what you're currently thinking.
You sang it this morning, and I am a child of God.
Yeah. I am a child of God. Will you guys stand up with me? And it does feel silly to yell at yourself in the mirror.
It works.
But I love what they said at Christian International when I was there. Prophetic acts always make your flesh feel silly. Love that. You know it's the Spirit when it makes your flesh feel silly. That's what we're going to do today.
Yeah.
That's what we're going to do. So, we are going to declare over ourselves as silly as it sounds.
Yes.
And guess what? It's all going to be different because we're all in different spots.
Yes.